Okay, so this talk will be based on a set of different papers which appeared pretty recently, and let me explain what it is. So I guess we all know the basic idea of string theory landscape, that you probably, possibly have lots of different vacua, like how many we do not know, but many. And then if you calculate, well, quantum corrections to them, it will be all reshuffled. So the problem is how it will be with quantum corrections, how they affect your results, what will be if the results are unreliable. They will move like that, but hopefully in this small range, they will have still enough vacua which will explain why the cosmological constant is as small as it is now. So this was at least until last summer a leading paradigm, and we will see what happened well now. So first, a brief reminder about the KKLT story. So it is not exactly a reminder because this formulation is pretty new. It's KKLT, but in terms of nilpotent superfields, which kind of describe the effect of anti-D3 brain for uplifting. And that's how the theory looks. And these are the potentials which it produces. And these are the group of people who, well, created this new, more sophisticated way of thinking about it, okay? Now, this is another version of this theory. And for me, the previous one, well, essentially became not very interesting a long time ago in 2004, when we found that if you consider this previous picture in cosmology, then when Hubble constant becomes larger than gravitational mass, theory is decompactified, okay? So we found it and we decided we need to do something to keep the theory alive. So we invented the model where you can have, for a given set of parameters, you can have supersymmetric minimum just in Minkowski, okay? And then we do not need to have significant uplifting. We just need to have a very small uplifting. Or we can have slightly ADS and uplifted back to DS. But this uplifting will be many orders of magnitude smaller than the barrier. Therefore, we will maintain stability in difficult cosmological environments. So this was in all of our, well, cosmological constant, cosmological models setting. This was the model which we had in mind. These are generalizations of this model. We have several different fields. We can have a scenario. This is so-called STU model. We have a scenario. We have many different fields. And still, we have a possibility at the first approximation, supersymmetric Minkowski minimum, then slightly make it ADS, slightly uplift it back. So relation between supersymmetry breaking and height of the potential is the same as in this previous model. And again, in this set of models, you can have a possibility to have stability in cosmological background. Now, there are some news about which Renata will tell you in her talk. And that is going beyond just KKLT and anti-D3 brain. So first, we had this idea of anti-D3 brain. And then lately, what was found that the role of this uplifter can be played by more complicated, by other type of fields, anti-DP brains, if they erupt in such a way that they will later effectively lead to the same effect as anti-D3 brain. This was in a very recent paper by them, and they have found some De Sitter states because of some additional contribution from the terms which appear there. Renata will tell you. I think that this is pretty important, potentially at least. Okay. Now, when we study everything in terms of nilpotent fields, there are some rather unusual conditions which should be satisfied by the theory. So if you have superpotential, the derivative of the superpotential with respect to the nilpotent superfield must be non-equal to zero. Otherwise, the theory, even if it is violated in one point in the model space, the theory becomes inconsistent. And that is if you have canonical Keller of, like we have written before. But if you have a generic Keller, then it is written in a slightly more complicated way, but the, for canonical Keller it's the same. Okay, so that's important that they must be satisfied in at every point of the modular space. And again, if you want to have details, ask Renate exactly why this so. So why this strangely became very important now? Because, well, at String 2018, Wafa made a talk which he started like that. I would like to entertain a hypothesis which is in fact a pure speculation. Then he repeated it two times after that, speculation, speculation, okay? A week later, there was a paper by Brandenberger saying that we know now that De Sitter states are incompatible with string theory, and therefore, so this is how it is. And people in panic rushed to the exit door, started producing models of inflation, which despite the total disaster can be still compatible with what Wafa suggested, okay? So what he suggested, essentially it can be sliced into two different suggestions. First, along with several other people, that De Sitter space is incompatible with string theory. That's a general idea, okay? We will discuss why. And second suggestion, more concrete, that you have gradient of the scalar field, of the potential with respect to scalar field, greater than some constant, and this constant was supposed to be of the order one. Of course, when you look at it and you understand that it's string theorist who is speaking, we remember that when we were making models based on KKLT cosmological back in 2003, I found that from the point of view of string theorist, you consider, for example, relation between Planckian mass and string constant in different dimensions, and you find out that there is some volume involved. And in volume, there is two, for example, for six torus, it's 2π/6. So the general idea was 2π/6 is one, okay? So with this accuracy, this is not very informative, but, okay. But that's how it is. They usually have this number of the order one. And the example of the legitimate potential, it's exponential potential. In fact, it is a very good example because if you have this inequality violated in some, so what you are trying to do to maximize the probability that it works in cosmology, you make it slope as small as possible, okay? So as small as possible, it is better if you take it as small as possible all the way for all phi, and this is like a bound for like one, then this will be exponent. If you have any potential which has some parts where the slope is higher than that, then it is bad. So the best potential for them is pure exponent, okay? So now the question is, first of all, you immediately recognize that this is opposite to what was what is well required for consistent quintessence, because you need to have a potential which is as flat as possible, and they insist that it should be greater than something. So why no ds and why a large slope of v? And arguments which were suggested in the papers by them, they well divided into several groups. One is Maldacena and Nunes theorem, which however may not apply to KKLT type of construction. Another is the theorem which was proven in 85 by Pilch and Nieuwenhuizen, who is saying, Sonius saying that supergravity is incompatible with this, yes.
Just a small comment. Number one doesn't apply to any of the
centers. Okay, thank you. Now, okay, so now if you can, what it is, De Sitter doesn't appear in supergravity, but if you look carefully, you will actually look into history. People at some moment panicked that this is a generic statement. They tried to overcome it one way or another, and they didn't even notice that in the theory of phenomenological supergravity with matter field, there are De Sitter states explicitly constructed. It was working only for pure supergravity. And now we have a version of de Sitter supergravity using nilpotent superfields, where this condition, well, this theorem does not matter. You have de Sitter even without any scalar fields. But with scalar fields, the example is this. This is famous Polanyi model. You have this is general expression for potential. You take superpotential, the simplest possible. And for the simplest possible potential, you get potential like that. This for special choice of beta, which is in every textbook, beta like that, you have potential which has just Minkowski space, but in minimum. But if you change beta, you have either ADS or DS. So this was all not a problem for phenomenological supergravity. Now we have models where it is possible, even in the absence of scalar fields, have a de Sitter state in supergravity. And the thing which was done essentially, if we look back on this thing, what was bad about it? You need to introduce an extra scalar, okay? And you need to interpret this scalar. Interpreting this scalar in string theory is difficult. So right now we do not need to introduce a scalar, but instead you introduce nilpotent field, which is which has a string theory interpretation. Okay. Now they brought even this, and then when I looked at it, and this was in the concluding section of the paper, I just oh, okay. So there is a theorem of Fari and Goose that you cannot create a de Sitter universe in a laboratory. And I thought, oh my God, they probably did not know that our universe was probably not created in a laboratory. So, so now we have a more serious discussion. And since most of the players are around, it is possible well, to go to the depth of it. Well, it is really supposed to be a friendly discussion. And we'll hope to keep it like that. But it is really desirable to understand where we are in that. Because the statement which was made some time ago is that there is no KKLT. It is inconsistent, actually. So if you compare the model which they proposed, it was different by introduction of one term here with a coefficient C. And this coefficient C was supposed to be much larger than the original term, which was describing completely, yes? But this was supposed to be a representation of 10-dimensional description of KKLT, wasn't it?
Only for one model, for the model with one volume module. We cannot say anything about KKLT as a whole.
Okay, good. Okay. So that's good, okay. So right now, let's consider this. So when we looked at this potential, the argument was that this C must be much, much greater than B, okay? And this was surprising because it was supposed to be back reaction. And usually, if you have some term which creates back reaction, then the back reaction must be smaller. Indeed, it is exponentially suppressed. But at small t, it we would be expect that if B is suppressed because of the warping, then why C is not suppressed by the warping. But in any case, we decided to check this model. And this was the model as described in the paper by Westphal and collaborators. And it is a very interesting plotting. This parameter C, so it's not imaginary part of the field. This is the field which is supposed to be stabilized. So for KKLT model, if you change C at B equals 0, so if you look at this, if you ignore the original term here and plot it like that, then you will see that when C increases, there is no de Sitter minimum here. Meanwhile, in KL model, you have everything fine. So you C increases, you still have a minimum there, perfect. So when we looked at this model originally, we say, okay, so KKLT, who cares? KL, we have good. So why don't we just forget about it? And that's what we did. But now, Waffa and others, for them, this is a reference number, essentially number one. All other papers that are mostly talking, and this one is saying something, okay? So now, what we studied, when we studied this model, we have found that this construction with this C greater than B is actually inconsistent with the conditions of nilpotence. So the trick is that you calculate this DSW, which I mentioned before about consistency, and you found that there is a solution in the moduli space in one particular point and some imaginary t, where this quantity vanishes. And the consistency is that it should not vanish anywhere. So consistency condition means that AC is smaller than B, just for consistency. If it is smaller than B, then the standard KKLT results are valid. There is no changes. But we decided to check nevertheless. What if we just use these calculations, and what will be with the potentials? And what we found, indeed, that if we start with original anti-de Sitter minimum, you increase C, it then moves it here, the minimum. And then you increase B, and it produces you, in this model, produces you de Sitter minimum. And what is interesting, that this picture is for C equal 1, you see this uplift due to this parameter C, which is large, okay? It's like 1/5 of the way. And all the rest is done by this tiny, tiny constant B, which means that it is dangerous to say this factor is big, this factor is large, small. So forget the small one with comparison, in comparison with the big one. And the main reason is that this big one is multiplied by exponent. So at large t, you may have this term unimportant as compared to this one, okay? So now there was a response to what we said, and the response was let's consider a more general model, and it's pretty complicated. So instead of having B here and C somewhere else, you just treat, it is a legitimate operation. You can put everything here in the denominator of this term in Keller potential, and this function can be any, and the suggestion was to take this. So our comment on that is if you have C larger than B as in the previous model, okay, then this model is equally inconsistent as the previous one. If C is smaller than B, then everything is fine, the model is consistent. So this term becomes small. Where the source of inconsistency? Just think about small t. When the t is small, this term, this exponent is 1, this is as it is, and this one is proportional to t, so it disappears. So everything hangs on these two terms. If this one is bigger than that, and it's bigger, if c is greater than b divided by 2, then this term at small t is negative, and that is bad. Okay. So if you avoid this, c is smaller than b divided by 2, and just play the whole game on this parameter and look. In order to disprove KKLT, kind of, you previously suggestion was to introduce one parameter, and now you need to have two parameters. So if this new parameter is large enough, then you can have a consistent model, assuming that C is small. But in this case, we just have de Sitter minimum. We checked it, so we have it. Okay. So now what we did recently, and that was meaning just yesterday, the new paper. So we can suggest a very simple modification, if we want to modify anything, because we do not feel that we need. But if we want to modify anything, then you have, again, a series of de Sitter minima depending on C. Of course, you may say that, well, this works when C is, very, very large. But look here. We have C equal 1, and parameter B maximum is 10 to the minus 5. So we satisfy every, desire which was expressed, and then we have de Sitter minima. Now, maybe in 10D theory, you must have, super large C. So what we studied the models like that in the first our paper, with C equal 10 to the 4, and B 10 to the minus 5. So the difference is 9 orders of magnitude. We found de Sitter minima. Then one may ask, okay, so maybe you found this minimum, but radiative corrections will push you to the wall, and you do not trust your result. So I do not know which result we should trust. But at the moment, I would say that we have something, and that's already interesting. So at the moment, we do not see any obvious reason to abandon this type of models. But again, let's wait, because we may not understand some subtleties which Westphal had in mind, so we will hear about them. Okay, this now is the new kind of picture reflecting the possibility that we still might have some, well, slow roll places which Waffa and others want, and this is legitimate, that is okay. We do not really know that we are sitting in the sitter space. We may sit in quintessence, but now let's check. So the condition for this lambda parameter, lambda should be smaller than one at three sigma level. So if lambda is larger than one in the parameter, which is what formally Waffa wants, then the models are just dead. But the problem is not whether Waffa wants or not, but the problem is that they presented the set of models which they consider legitimate from the point of view of string theory, and the answer is that for all of these models, they're all ruled out. Every single model which they mentioned in the first paper, they're just ruled out. Now, another question is whether we should apply the conjecture to inflationary theory, and I have no idea, because I have no idea what was the derivation of the conjecture. I think that this was just a statement, a desire, whatever. So in inflationary models, for consistency of the slow roll inflation, for having perturbations smaller than one, you already have a constraint. Without asking Waffa for permission, we have this constraint. So we everything is satisfied except for in observable part of the universe, this constraint right now using Planck data gives you 1/10. And then of course, when I say 1/10 is over order one, so I don't know what do you do about that. Okay, what is important that we should take the data seriously, and the data tell you something about this. You can avoid it by making complicated models like one of the models described yesterday. So you have steep potential and steep inflation. This would, however, rule out like 99% of inflationary models. And they say, okay, so we have a string gas cosmology. So string gas cosmology. The last time I studied it, because after that, I mean, I could not force neither me nor my collaborators to even look into this direction. Look into this direction, because they said that we have everything without inflation, and NS is of the order one. Okay, no, actually one. Oh, with some. So when we calculated, Mukhanov looked at it and said, they have N equal 5. I say, what? Yes, so they had N equal 5. And they've written a paper after that independently, or kind of after we explained them the problem. So they also had N equal 5, but they did not say it by words. They just written equation and say it does not matter, because as soon as we stabilize dilaton, everything will become normal, except when you stabilize dilaton, their basic solution disappears. So that is how it is, and therefore, if somebody wants to study it, I think that idea is brilliant. Idea is very, very good, but implementation. Okay, so now quintessence. I just mentioned that they all do not work. The presently available does not mean that you cannot do anything. You might, but then you need to consider all these kind of questions: stability with respect to quantum corrections, fifth force decompactification. That is not a joking matter, because in the first model of Waffa, space completely decompactifies. He apparently does not know. It was done in our paper with Renata in 2003. And he thought that he considers a new model probably. In the second model, volume of compactified space grows 180 orders of magnitude during inflation. Now, another thing, it's kind of funny, that if you really start exponent from Planckian density to the present density, then the field changes by approximately 400, which violates their own weak gravity conjecture. And of course, you may say, I do not expect the theory to be valid all the way. You can make it steep first, you can make it slow, but then in the vicinity of 10 to the minus 120, if you think that the theory is valid from 10 to the minus 110 to up one order of magnitude, it's already give you a phi greater than one, so like three or something.
I think this is not a weak gravity conjecture, right?
It is the statement about excursion. there are so many different versions of weak gravity conjecture that I don't know how to refer to them. I'm just saying that if you look at the talks by Wafa, he says, oops, we have something about order one, this can be a problem. So he mentioned it as a problem of his own.
Well, I think in New York,
Yes, there are some people, and some of them just gave a talk yesterday, treating it very carefully. But if you just say, oh, excursions of the order like 400 are totally excluded, well, so that's what they are dealing with. So the conclusion is, at the moment, there is too early to abandon the standard string theory landscape. And also, at the moment, we do not see any available model which would produce quintessence of a desirable type. And if there will be any models, then our conjecture is that they should satisfy this kind of condition. And our second conjecture that this is not even a conjecture.